Well, Nasstar provides hosted, managed and cloud computing services that enable subscribers to access their corporate desktop, files, applications, data and email in the cloud rather than using local server infrastructure. Well, it's been highly acquisitive over the last 2 years, and today the company has announced plans to buy Modrus for a total consideration of £13 million. The Chief Executive, Nigel Redwood, joins me now. So, Nigel, first of all, what does Modrus do?
Good morning, Sarah. Modrus is a supplier of IT managed services. It delivers its service based on a per user per month process, and it will actually host all of a client's application set. So everything from the commodity applications like email and office, all the way through to all of their legacy applications and data. They'll supply everything from the piece of kit on site for a client, all of the networking and all of the hosting and private cloud, and integrate that with public cloud offerings as well as if necessary. Very similar to Nasstar, Modrus goes to market by targeting vertical sectors, and it specializes in media services, property services, independent software vendors, financial sector, and the recruitment sector.
So how long has it been in your sights for then? When did it come to your attention and you thought, that would be a nice fit?
Modrus has been on our radar for some years. I've known the MD, Ed Armitage, down there for about 3 years. And certainly we've competed against each other in the recruitment sector for a number of years also. So yeah, a good number of years.
So in terms of the MD, you've known him for a while. Is he staying on board?
Ed is staying on board. He's joining the operating exec board at Nasstar PLC, and he's staying on board to help the integration and aid our business moving forward.
Okay, so I suppose there was an advantage to knowing the MD when you made the deal, because £13 million looks fair value indeed. But how is the deal being structured, and you know, do you have shareholder support?
Absolutely. So Modrus's year end is actually March, so they've just closed down their March 2016 numbers, where they achieved £6.1 million of revenues with EBITDA profits of £1.6 million. Of those revenues, 86% are contracted monthly recurring revenues, so a good high quality business. So £13 million for the total consideration, that represents just over 8x EBITDA. So we think it is very good value. In terms of how we structured the deal, we are paying £11.7 million in cash with the remainder in consideration shares. And we've done a fund raise in the city for £13.3 million to actually fund the transaction. So 11.7 million of that will be spent on the consideration, and the remaining 1.6 million will be sent on acquisition costs, but more importantly, to lower our net debt ratio.
Okay, we'll talk about the net debt later, but in terms, so you've told me about the synergies with Modrus, you've told me about the MD and the personnel and the human capital. So I'm guessing that this acquisition is building upon the acquisition of eno.net business that you made in January 2014, Comanche in 2014 and Vesk last year. So there's synergies across all of those purchases that you've made in the last 2 years?
Absolutely there is. And I mean, each purchase has very different strategic reasons. Modrus has two key factors for us. One is about building resilience into our client base. If you look how we go to market at the moment as a group, we target four vertical markets. That's government not-for-profit, finance, recruitment, and the legal sector. So Modrus brings us three additional vertical markets to target in media, property services and ISVs. And it dilutes our reliance on the previous four vertical markets. So it's very much about building resilience into that customer base and increasing the target market for our services. The second key reason is an operational one. There's many synergies that we can identify with a business like this. Modrus actually have a New Zealand office for their 24/7 support, and that's very attractive to us because we have to operate a true 24/7 rota throughout the UK for all of our clients, We have logistical clients, utility clients. We have clients in Singapore where their daytime is our evening, and we have to put a full shift of 24/7 working on. So being able to support that with a New Zealand office is very attractive for us as well. And then naturally, synergies such as data center integrations, admin, finance, HR, those types of operations are all very much achievable.
So you've got a global reach and it allows you to get some sleep then as well.
It allows our UK team to maybe to get some sleep. I mean, it's about bolstering our capabilities. So, yeah, absolutely.
And is the business model, you know, your expansion strategy still one of organic growth augmented by selective acquisitions?
That's right. I mean, the selective acquisitions have to bring us more than just growth. They've all got a strategic purpose. We're very much focused on contracted recurring revenues, naturally, as a group. Post this acquisition, we'll have 88% of our revenues will be contracted recurring. Our future strategy is very much to integrate Modrus and maximise the operational gearing. We're still integrating Vest that we acquired in October 2015, and Modrus will form part of that integration. And so for the next 12 months, we'll be very much focusing to make sure we can maximise those synergies. So going into 2018, we get the biggest return for shareholders. And I think towards the end of that period, towards the end of 2017, is when additional acquisitions will be considered.
Okay, so you still have targets in your sights then, but you're wanting to integrate, and I'm sensing you're wanting to chip away at the net debt as well.
Yes, I mean, one of the key reasons for the overfund is to lower our net debt this year. So by the end of 2017, we'll be in a net cash position. So we'll be in a £600,000 net cash position by the end of 2017. And that will put us in a much better position to raise funds via bank debt, perhaps for the next raise, making the return for shareholders that came in on this raise much greater at that point.
Okay, so 2018 sounds like a key year then, when you've integrated the acquisitions, the current acquisitions. But 2018, you said you want to, you know, maximise shareholder returns. What is it about 2018 that makes you say that?
Well, it's just logistical. You know, since we did the reverse in January 2014. We've been on an acquisition cycle, and the logistics of integrating and maximising the return just takes a time. So you can't do too much all at once. I mean, the key thing with integrations like this is to protect the client and the customer and the employees. So everything we do has got to ensure that the service to the customers is maintained or improved. So you can't do integrations quickly. It's a matter of logistical timing.
Okay, well, let's have a look at now. Currently, what is the market worth that you're operating in? What are you chasing?
The market's ever expanding. I mean, as a business, Nasstar historically was operating in a very early adoption market base. You know, cloud services and in the early 2000s was a very difficult sell. We went into 2012 and 2013, and the larger part end of the SME market was beginning to see our type of delivery model is the accepted norm, and that momentum continues to build. So the market in all of our sectors continues to grow as businesses decide that actually delivering IT in-house is difficult, it's uncompliant, it's costly. The market's ever growing.
Very good. Nigel Redwood, Chief Executive of Nasstar, thank you very much indeed for joining us today.
Thanks, Sarah. Thank you.